we will now dive into some of the key details of prokaryotic replication. One of the major features of prokaryotic DNA is that it's circular in nature, and the size of the chromosomal DNA is much smaller than the eukaryotic counterpart. Thus, replication is typically characterized by having one origin of replication, or ori. The ori is the site where the DNA double helix opens up, and each of the strands can then be used as template to synthesize the new daughter strand. This is shown here with the dashed circles. The dashed blue and the dashed red circles represent the new daughter DNA. Notice the DNA replication is bidirectional, and it moves outward from the origin of replication in both directions on both template strands. This next table is a nice summary of the major enzymes that are required for prokaryotic DNA replication. We will work our way through the major players. Notice that this table has a column where the enzymes are listed, as well as the gene names in E. coli that encode for these proteins. Some of the diagrams that we look at may refer to the genes that are listed here, so use this table as a guide when you need some clarification. This diagram gives a nice overview of the major enzymes and proteins involved with DNA replication. Once the origin has been opened up, exposing the single-stranded DNA, a DNA replication fork can form. Leading this way is the DNA helicase enzyme that's involved in unwinding the double-stranded DNA to create a single-stranded bubble. You can see the entire bubble here, and then the expanded view that we're looking at in the larger diagram. When the DNA helicase unwinds the double-stranded DNA to create the replication bubble, this creates increased tension upstream of the replication fork. The DNA topoisomerase enzymes are utilized to reduce supercoiled tension during the replication process. Single-stranded binding proteins will bind to the DNA and keep it from reforming the double helix. Note that each strand of the DNA is lying in the opposite orientation. One in the 5' to 3' orientation, and the other in the 3' to 5' orientation. Recall that DNA synthesis can only occur in the 5' to 3' direction, with the insertion of the new nucleotides at the 3' hydroxyl of the previous base. Thus, for bidirectional synthesis to occur, only one strand can move in the forward direction, the one that will be growing in the 5' to 3' direction. This is called the leading strand, or continuous synthesis strand. The other strand that's moving in the opposite direction is called the lagging strand. The lagging strand has to be built in short bursts as it's moving in the opposite direction of the replication fork. So this DNA has to wind back around and go through the replication machinery so that it can synthesize in the correct orientation, but move away from the replication fork at the same time. Thus, each fragment has to dissociate from the complex and then jump back to start the synthesis of the next fragment. So you get these smaller fragments that are shown here. The smaller fragments are known as Okazaki fragments after the researcher that discovered them. So the DNA polymerase enzyme is the major enzyme that mediates the replication process and introduces the new base into the growing DNA strands. And the DNA polymerase enzymes require a few key components to be able to mediate DNA replication. First, it must have a template strand, so the parent strands that you're using, to be able to add in the new bases. It has to know which base comes next, and that's decided by the template strand. It must also have a primer to be able to incorporate the next base onto. It cannot just start the new strand de novo without anything else to add it to. So, in the case of DNA synthesis, a small RNA primer must be laid down first on the template, and then the polymerase can start adding onto that primer. So DNA polymerases, they need a template, and they also need a primer. Only one primer is required for the leading strand because you don't have any breaks in the synthesis process. So at the very beginning of the replication process, you would have a small primer that would be added to the leading strand, and then it would continue. The lagging strand has to have multiple RNA primers that get set down on the template every time it has to shift back and start the next fragment. The RNA primase enzyme shown in green mediates this process of placing the RNA primers down on the lagging strand and at the very beginning on the leading strand as well. Another DNA polymerase enzyme will end up removing these RNA primers from the sequence and replacing them with DNA. The sugar phosphate backbone in between the Okazaki fragments can then be resealed by the DNA ligase enzyme. Within the next few slides, we'll take a look at this process in more detail. So the initiation of replication at the origin requires the assembly of a protein complex known as the primosome. This diagram shows the assembly of the DNA primosome. This involves the binding of an initiator protein to the origin sequence. In E. coli, this initiator is encoded for by the DNA A gene. The DNA A initiator protein binds to ATP and specific sequences at the ORI. DNA A is a long snake-like protein that contains multiple subunits. Domains 3 and 4 are the most visible in this diagram. Binding of DNA A plus ATP causes torsional strain at the origin of replication and initiates the unwinding process. DNA C, shown here in red, is the helicase loader, and it interacts with the DNA A protein that's bound to the origin of replication. It also traps the DNA B helicase enzyme in this open lock washer conformation, or it looks like a letter C. This enables it to slide over the single-stranded DNA. Domain 1 of the DNA A protein also helps to capture a second DNA B and DNA C complex that gets loaded onto the opposite strand of the bubble. This will help form the bidirectional nature of the DNA replication process. One DNA helicase will move in one direction, and the other DNA helicase will move in the other direction or opposite direction of the replication bubble. So once the DNA C protein falls off of this area, the DNA B helicase will form a closed ring structure around the single-stranded DNA, and this forms the functional primosome. The DNA B helicases can then begin to unwind the DNA at the new replication fork, and the DNA G primase enzyme will start adding RNA primers to both the lagging and the leading strand. So E. coli has a total of 5 DNA polymerase enzymes, 3 of which are involved in the DNA replication process, and they're numbered 1, 2, and 3. DNA polymerase 3 is the main polymerase that's involved in DNA replication. It synthesizes most of the leading strand and the Okazaki fragments during DNA replication. The DNA polymerase 3 holoenzyme is comprised of 10 different proteins organized into 3 functionally distinct but physically interconnected assemblies. The first one is the core, shown here. This contains the alpha, epsilon, and theta subunits. The second domain is the beta sliding clamp, which is shown in red here. And the third complex is the clamp loader complex. So figure A shows a standard textbook diagram of the DNA replisome with the coupled and highly coordinated processes of both the leading and the lagging strand synthesis. And they show this happening on both templates concurrently. You can see that the single-stranded lagging strand is looped back around so that it can synthesize the Okazaki fragments in the 5' to 3' direction. However, as shown in figure B, recent studies have shown that E. coli DNA polymerase 3 is readily exchangeable at the fork, and the leading strand and the lagging strand synthesis may not be tightly coupled, or can even be accomplished by different DNA polymerase 3 enzymes altogether. The DNA B helicase can also be uncoupled from the DNA polymerase complex, and it can translocate ahead of the apex of the fork. So DNA polymerase 3 has both DNA polymerase and proofreading capabilities, which give it really high fidelity. Typically, it has an error rate of 1 in 1 million bases. DNA polymerase 3 polymerase activity is shown here with the incorporation of the deoxythymidine triphosphate into the growing chain. Occasionally, there's an extension error where the wrong nucleotide might be incorporated into the growing nucleotide. Here you can see that an adenine has been added across from a cytosine rather than the correct guanine base. In this case, the proofreading capabilities of the polymerase utilize a 3' to 5' exonuclease activity to remove the misincorporated base. The normal polymerase activity and extension of the new DNA strand can now continue. So overall, DNA polymerase 3 has 5' to 3' polymerase activity and 3' to 5' proofreading exonuclease activity. Cryo-electron microscopy structures of the DNA polymerase 3 core, clamp, and the tau clamp loader are shown here, with the DNA polymerase in the polymerization mode and in the proofreading mode. This shows that there is a lot of flexibility in the DNA polymerase, especially in the thumb region of the polymerase, such that the DNA polymerase is adding a base and then shifting it into the proofreading area before it moves forward to add the next base. This diagram shows a side view of the DNA polymerase 3 protein with special detail for the flexible movement of the tau binding domain and the oligonucleotide binding domain when the polymerase is free or when it's bound to the DNA molecule. This video clip shows the flexibility of the DNA molecule, especially the tau binding domain and the oligonucleotide binding domain. DNA polymerase 1 is involved mainly with primer removal and replacement during DNA replication, as well as with DNA proofreading. In addition to the 5' to 3' polymerase activity and the 3' to 5' exonuclease proofreading abilities, the DNA polymerase 1 enzyme also has 5' to 3' exonuclease activity. This means that the DNA polymerase 1 can remove the RNA primer sequences that are laid down along the lagging strand during DNA replication and replace that sequence with DNA. The E. coli DNA polymerase is shown on the left and was crystallized without the 5' to 3' exonuclease domain. The green outline shows where this portion of the protein would normally be. The structure on the right is the full-length DNA polymerase 1 enzyme from Thermus aquaticus. Note that DNA polymerase 2 is predominantly utilized in the repair of mismatched bases following DNA replication and has some overlapping function with the DNA 1 polymerase. However, it's not involved with the removal of the primers and replacement of that primer sequence. That is only done by DNA polymerase 1. So once the DNA polymerase 3 is finished synthesizing the bulk of the DNA, you will notice that the lagging strand of each replication fork has many primers throughout the sequence. These cannot be removed by DNA polymerase 3 as it does not have the 5' to 3' exonuclease activity. Thus, when DNA polymerase 3 runs into the downstream primer, it falls off of the DNA and is finished with its synthesis ability. The DNA polymerase 1 enzyme will link on to the newly synthesized DNA and it will scan the sequence until it finds primer regions. The 5' to 3' exonuclease activity will be used to cleave off the RNA primers and replace them with the DNA bases. The one thing that the DNA polymerase 1 enzyme cannot do, it cannot seal the breaks in the DNA backbone within the lagging strand in between the Okazaki fragments. The DNA ligase enzyme will be required for this purpose, and we'll take a look at that over the next few slides.